There's no better way to explore the Hebrides than this. The Island Harvester will be my home for the next month afloat, and we're heading for places where there's no handy 24-hour deli just round the corner. This week, I'm heading for the tiny island with the intriguing name, Muck. At just over 2 miles from east to west, Muck is a fertile little island, and I made landfall in glorious weather to meet the laird and farmer, Lawrence McEwen.
Good morning, Nick. Welcome to Muck.
Thanks, lads.
That's good.
What a change in the weather.
I know, it's fantastic. What a change from last night. Good to meet you in person. Right, that was very welcome. This is just glorious. So where are these cows of yours, Lawrence?
They're just up the road, about a mile. I'll take you up there.
In here?
Yes, just jump in. I'll drive.
Muck is the most fertile of the small isles and has a long history of settlement. Today it is a thriving, idyllic farming community, running at a pace that is truly out of this world. Yesterday's newspapers, no mains electricity, and no cars. This is as close as it gets to a traffic jam.
How many coos have you got here?
Oh, about 3 at the moment.
The climate and landscape of Muck allows Lawrence to keep a small dairy herd, and that means fresh milk.
In the old days, the lassies who used to milk, they used to sing, and the cows were accustomed to him singing, and he let the milk down faster.
So, Lawrence, tell me a bit about the island. How long have your family been here?
They've been here 100 years and 6 months. My granduncle bought the island, and he paid £5,500 for it. I think he was slightly eccentric.
What actually happens to the milk once you've milked the cows?
Well, first it's strained and goes into a basin, and then in the morning, most of the milk is distributed to everybody in the island. They send their cans up and I fill them up. It's sort of part of a barter system. They do work for me and I give them milk.
You keep everybody in milk.
What doesn't end up in the islanders' cans is taken back to the farmhouse, where Lawrence's wife, Jenny, whips it up into butter. All of which was making me very hungry, and so we set off to collect some ingredients for lunch. Although you'd hardly believe it's day, Muck gets cut off by Atlantic gales during the winter, and the McEwens have got used to providing for themselves. As well as milk, cream and butter, Jenny keeps free-range hens and has a magnificent walled garden full of herbs and vegetables. I could feel a quiche coming on.
So, Jenny, you've made a blind baked base for the quiche. How do you make the filling?
Right, now then, we've got 4 eggs here.
Colour of those yolks is just fantastic,
yes,
isn't it?
This is spinach. It's very fresh. It's literally sort of 2 minutes in boiling water and salt. And then this is the soft
cheese. Is this your own?
Yes, it is. Yes.
Double cream?
Yes.
From your own cows?
Own cows, yes. And that goes in. And the seasoning.
I'm beginning to wonder if there's anything in this dish that isn't your own, that hasn't come from the farm or your garden.
One onion softened in olive oil. Right now, then we'd give it a good
mix
swirl around.
Can I give you a hand with that?
Yes, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Make some contribution to the...
yes.
I'm quite good at stirring.
Good, I can see. You're a professional.
I've got my stirring ticket.
that's great. Right, and now we're just going to just tip the filling in.
And what temperature are you going to bake it?
Oh, fairly hot for the first 10 minutes or so, and then lower shelf for the next half an hour or so.
With 30 minutes to go before the quiche is ready, it was time for a spot of slow cooking myself.
Boy, that's good. That is absolutely delicious.
Oh, good.
Gorgeous. Mm. Now, listen, it's been suggested that I should be called Island Scrounger rather than Island Harvester. Any chance of raiding your dairy larder to replenish my ship's stores?
We'll certainly send you on your way well quick.
Thank you very much.
caught dram in hand again. However, there is a reason for this, because this is an ingredient in my next dish, which is a bread and butter pudding with a difference. Now, over here on the stove, we've got some of that mucky farm produce. In here, I've got half a pint of milk, half a pint of double cream, and a vanilla pod. Now, I've just cut that in half, scraped the seeds out, and allowed that to infuse for however long it takes to drink a wee whiskey. Now, that's nearly come to the boil. I'm just going to turn up the heat just to bring it right up to the boil. And over here, I've got 5 farm eggs, 2 ounces of caster sugar, and I'm just going to whisk those together. And you can see that fantastic colour that you get when you're using real farm eggs. Just a couple of minutes of whisking, and hopefully this cream will be up at the boil any second now. OK, so we'll take the pan and we'll pour 2/3 of the hot cream onto the yolks, whisking all the time and working really quickly now, OK, so it doesn't cool down. Take the contents of the bowl, which are the eggs and the cream, back in there, and without pausing, straight in with a wooden spoon this time. Now, wooden spoons are much better for moving hot custard about than a whisk. There's a time that the mixture just thickens and becomes oily looking, and that is just there. Can you see that kind of oily look on the surface? That is a perfectly thickened custard. Now, what I'm doing here is I've got some scones that have been hanging about in the boat for a couple of days. They're a wee bit stale, but they're perfect for this. So instead of using bread in the bread and butter pudding, I'm going to use scones. I'm just taking the crispy crusts off and then slicing them into thirds. And I had an idea when I saw the scones as well. What I've got here is ramekins, little individual 3-inch ramekins, and I've buttered these. And the scone tends to fit perfectly inside a ramekin. So I thought I'd make individual bread and butter puddings, or scone and butter puddings. So lay them out and give them a good heavy buttering. In here, I've got some sultanas, and I've soaked them in a bit of my whiskey. It was hard to do, but I've done it anyway. And they're going to take on all that lovely malt whiskey, that really kind of peaty, smoky flavour. And we're going to use those as the fruit. Pour in just a smidgen of custard into the bottom, like so. Then one of the rounds of buttered scone. And then a teaspoon or so of the whiskey of sultana over the top there. A little bit more custard. Another disc of scone. And then just fill the ramekin. Okay, we touch more. Now, what you have to do here is you need to leave these to sit, preferably for about an hour. And what happens is the scones just absorb all the custard. Right, so just pop the last one in there, and I've got 1/2 inch of warm water in the bottom of that roasting tin just to stop them burning the bottom. And now I'm going to pop them into the oven, roughly gas mark 5, as near as I can figure out in this oven. And we'll just leave them in there for 45 minutes. And here they are, fresh from the oven. And the only thing that remains to do is to taste them. Ooh, they're browned up nicely on top. And look at that, look at those layers. One of these days, I'm going to make something and I'm going to say, that is absolutely dreadful. But not today, because this is gorgeous. Alas, my time in muck was over, and it was time to move on again, this time towards the misty mountains of Rum. That's Rum in the distance there, the shadowy peaks with muck in the foreground. It's only about 10 to 12 miles to get around to it, so I've got a couple of hours, so I'm going to enjoy myself with a bit of fishing. Mackerel fishing, none of your poncy fly fishing here. Yep, there we go! Now, this is real fishing. Look! Up we come, my beauties, and in my bucket you go. Whoa! Right, so hooks out and just a quick snap back of the head. That's to be sorted for tea tonight. So, time to head off to Rum. I'm just turning into Loch Scresort, and right up there at the head of the loch you can just make out Kinloch Castle, where we'll be staying.
And behind me, you've got the two highest peaks in Rum, Halival and Askival. But I've got to be very careful here, because there's a big reef sticking out here, and I don't want to hit it, so in we go.
Rum has by far the highest mountains of the small isles, and consequently has a very different climate to Muck. The guidebooks warn that it gets an average of 140 inches of rain a year. So when you get an evening like this, it calls for a bit of a barbie. Barbecued mackerel marinated with lemon, chilli and garlic, to be precise.
Now, what I've done with the mackerel is I've filleted it out, I've diced them into 1-inch pieces, pulled the wee bones out of them. The marinade couldn't be simpler. In here I've got one red chilli, roughly diced, seeds and all, and to that I'm going to add 2 cloves of garlic, finely chopped, and they go there, and then the zest of 1 lemon, again, finely chopped. 1 tablespoon of roughly chopped fresh coriander, and that goes there, and I just love all the colours on this. You've got the red of the chilli, the green of the coriander, the yellow of the lemon, and then to bind those together, a little bit of olive oil, 2 or 3 tablespoons of olive oil, and that goes there, and then the juice of 1/2 a lemon. Different flavours. The juice has the acidity, which is going to partly cure the mackerel, whereas the zest has all that really fresh citric flavour. And a little bit of seasoning, and then all you have to do is take the mackerel, just dump them into the marinade, and then give them a really good mix around. Make sure that all the ingredients are getting into the mackerel so they can soak up all those flavours. And then I'm just going to leave that to sit for an hour while the barbecue burns down, and then I'm going to thread them onto some skewers, whack them on the barbie, and that's my tea for tonight. Rum has a fascinating recent history. Throughout the early part of this century, it was owned by a Lancashire family, the Bullochs, as an island getaway. Kinloch Castle is a classic example of Edwardian opulence, and once housed turtles and alligators in heated tanks, and even birds of paradise in its conservatory. Not anymore, though. The island is now owned and managed by Scottish Natural Heritage and is a conservation area. The landscape on Rum doesn't support much farming, but I was assured I wasn't going to go hungry. Part of Scottish Natural Heritage's job here is to study and manage the herds of red deer, once introduced for sport. And every year, in the line of duty, they get to shoot a couple for the pot. OK, whereabouts are they?
They're just in the back of this knoll. There's a little flat. They're lying in at the foot of the steep there.
Aki Dempster is the head stalker today, and it's his job to select animals for the cull.
There are deer just over this rise, and next to them is the big stag that we're after. But unfortunately, there's a hind between us and stag. The problem is we have to go round the hind so we don't frighten it and it'll chase off the stag. So I'm just going up now off the bridge and have a look.
Although shooting deer gets mixed reactions, if this cull didn't take place, the island would soon overpopulate and the deer would die of starvation. This is not sport, it's an obligation and has to be carried out with skill and professionalism.
If you look on the left there, you see a set of antler. There's another one. He's got his head right down in the grass. Looked at him from further back there. He's a good old, mature stag. Good condition. He's never going to get any better. So
he's our boy.
He's our boy for the day, yeah.
So how's he normally to stand up?
Well, once this other one's up, you stand up. And which they are now taking an interest in them. It's only a matter of time before he sees that they're looking at us. Okay. And he's going to stand up. And whenever he stands up, I'll just drop him.
Right.
Do you want to look, Mike?
Yeah.
Thanks. There we go.
Look, he's moving.
Once a deer has been gralloched or disemboweled, there's only one way to get the carcass off the hill, on the back of a rum pony.
This is the only way to get them home, in a place like this.
All the deer killed in Rum are subject to extensive scientific study. Teeth, jawbones and antlers all provide valuable information on the animal's health. The meat, on the other hand, comes in for a different kind of scrutiny.
Come on, Sandy, get a move on. We're getting hungry here.
Here we go, guys.
A well-aged stew.
Lovely time.
Stalker's first.
This is stalker's stew, made from venison which hasn't been hung, on the understanding that if you've been up in the hills since dawn, you don't want to hang around for days till the meat cures. A couple of onions, a few carrots, a tin of beer, some rum venison, and a large helping of fresh air.
Very good.
Lovely.
All right. Right. Cracking.
Yeah, excellent.
No bad. Just see what you want after the hard doing there.
Back at the castle, all was quiet, so I decided to have a bit of a nosy. Many of the antiques here were brought from the Far East by Sir George Bullock, and are now shipwrecked and gathering dust in the castle corridors, giving the place a very strange atmosphere. Still, to the castle kitchen and on with the venison.
Okay, we're into full-on chef mode now. I've got 14 hungry gillies arriving here in about 3:30 now, 4 hours' time. Okay, so I'm going to cook for them now. Now, this is a saddle of venison, one that's been hung properly. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take out the two loins that lie either side of this carcass. And to do that, we'll just start down here, cutting through till I meet the bones at the bottom. Turn them round. Okay, and that's the first loin. And there's the second loin. There. Now, turn over the carcass, and underneath here you can see you've got the two fillets just lying in here. You can see there the texture's almost like plasticine. Free it away, knife just in there. Turn it around, cut through till it comes away nice and cleanly. Now, this may seem a bit extreme for home cooking, and it probably is. However, this is your butcher's job. Ask the butcher when you're buying the meat, give you the bones and ask him to chop them up for you. And that way you can make your own sauce to go with the venison. Now, on with the sauce. Over here. Okay, so we've got a hot roasting tray in here, a generous dollop of olive oil, and quickly get the meat over and get it in there. And this is to get it sealed and browned up. So that's where all the flavour and the sauce is going to come from. It's going to come from that lovely caramelised juices on the outside of the bones. Whole head of celery, just roughly chopped. We'll just fling that in with the meat. In that goes. Some carrots. And these will caramelise along with the meat juices. Whole head of garlic, just cut it across the circumference. A couple of onions, just quartered. Keep the skins on. And they go over here. There we go. With the spoon. Just give those a bit of a stir about. Okay, back over here again. Now, I'm just going to trim the sinew and the fat off the loins. Just get the knife in between the meat and the sinew. Cut back to make a little flap. Hold that. And then cut right up into the sinew. The knife won't go through the sinew. It will go through the meat, though. Okay, so that's the two loins ready. Right, okay. I can just smell now that this is just about ready to go in the oven for about 20 minutes or so. Right, while the bones are roasting in the oven, over back to the stove again. And I've got a big pot on here, got it nice and hot, bit of olive oil in there, and the trimmings from the saddle, they go in there as well. Now, the vegetable garnish for this dish is going to be a confit of carrots, celery, and onion. Just take them with a good sharp knife and cut them at 90 degree angles on the diagonal. Two things chefs love, high food and diagonals. Don't ask me why. We can see that the trimming's just browning away nicely in there. This isn't the stock, this is the base for the sauce. But I just want to get the maximum amount of flavour in here. So it's bones and trimmings, and I'm doing them separately. Okay, out we come. Oh, look at that. You can just see all those rich caramelised juices in it. Look at that. Look, that's flavour. Okay, but that's not ready yet. It needs another 20 minutes or so. Quickly, just one more of these. And we're over here again for a quick stir. Yeah, that's really starting to caramelise the bottom of the pan now. Just get in there and see what's happening in there. Really starting to take on some lovely colour. Right, at this stage, we start adding, first of all, the shallots and the garlic, and then the mushrooms and the thyme. And this looks extravagant, the amount of ingredients I'm putting in here. And if you wonder, next time you're in a fancy restaurant and somebody's trying to charge you 20 quid for a main course, that gives you some idea of where a lot of the money's going. Come and see this. This is where we're feeding these people tonight. This is the dining room these people are going to get to eat in. Check this out. Ta-da! Is that not fantastic? That's how the other half used to live. However, back to the stove. Right, okay, how's the sauce getting on? Now, that's really caramelised in the bottom now. It's starting to dry out. So we need to get some tinned tomatoes. Chopped tinned tomatoes, perfectly good for sauce. Better nice chopped plum tomatoes than cheap, nasty Dutch water balls. Bit of stir around there. Yes! Look at the colour in there. You just know that that's full of flavour. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to transfer the roasted bones and vegetables into here, the sauce base, the mushrooms, the shallots, the trimmings, and now the tomato. Okay, so I'm just transferring the bones and the veggies into the stock pot. Grab some vin rouge there, and in that goes. About half a bottle or so, another half bottle in here. And this is going to be a red wine sauce, so you do not spare on the red wine. At least one bottle. Wooden spoon. And just give this a little stir around until all those lovely caramelised deposits have been dissolved into the wine. And then we'll add that into the stock pot. I'm just going to let the wine reduce down for a couple of minutes, boil off the alcohol. Then we're going to cover this with cold water, bring it back to the boil, turn the heat down, and simmer it for, well, ideally 3 or 4 hours, but in our case, about 2.5 hours. Okay, that's the vegetables. We've got some nice new potatoes, just scrub those. These are island potatoes, picked from the island the day before yesterday. Sharp knife, I just trim off the bottom, square it off either end, and leave a nice little tower of potatoes about that height, and then do the same with all the rest. Keep them all the same depth. Right, I need a roasting tin, this will do here, and a little bit of butter. And just very lightly, plenty. Okay. We need to pack it in here. And then, take the potatoes, no excuses for this. This is fairly rich. Just press those down into the butter, and on they go there. And they'll just cook nice and slowly on top of the stove for about 40 minutes or so, and then we'll pop them into the oven just to finish them off cooking through. Okay, these veggies are cooking away nicely. The sauce, I can hear all the red wine is nearly evaporated, it's nearly boiled off. So what we're going to get now is some cold water, and just pour in enough to cover the bones. That's it there. Okay, the carrots and the celery have taken on a lovely dark colour on the outside. Just take another roasting tin and just empty them in there. Now, I've just turned over the stove potatoes and you can see that the side that's down is lovely and brown. What I'm going to do is going to put them into a low oven and cook them nice and slowly for about an hour and a half or so, if I can find... Whoa, those there. Okay, in they go, into the oven. Look! 7 o'clock, running out of time, 45 minutes to go. I should have had this off a bit before, but I wanted to get the maximum amount of flavour off it. Now, I'm just going to strain off the sauce through this colander and just leave that to sit there for 2 or 3 minutes, and then I'm going to pass it through this chinoise sieve into this pan, which I'll rinse out and reduce it down. That's the sauce. OK, the veggies are here. You can see them, the carrots and the celery. Just give them a mix together. And I'm just going to add a little bit of chopped garlic and chopped fresh thyme, and then I'll reheat those through the oven. The potatoes, check this out. That colour. colour. They absorb lots of that butter. Oh, they're all nice and crispy on the outside and soft on the inside. Into these hot frying pans, bit of oil. There we go. In with the venison. Just lift those over. Here we go. Right, into those hot pans. Yes. Get three pieces in each one. I'll just fry these in batches. Bit of butter in each pan. And the butter just helps to brown and froth up and foam. Make the venison real nice and rich. There we go. Okay, so we'll let those cook for about 2 or 3 minutes on each side. Then we'll just pop them into the oven to continue cooking. Where are the commie chefs? Where are the kitchen ports? Why am I doing this? It's just not on, you know. Head chefs sit in their office all day and drink champagne and have their friends around for dinner. They don't get up to their elbows in hot, sweaty sinks. Ah, time to turn the meat. It looks like that lovely colour on the outside. Nicely sealed and rich. Right, so carry on cooking those for a couple of minutes. Back to the sauce again. Skim, 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 skim. There they go. Right, so this is just pure sauce. Into this washed out pan. Into this beautifully washed out pan. In it goes. Fast reduction now. 1 tablespoon of round jelly, just to give it a little bit of sweetness. Just gonna pop the meat into the oven. 3 or 4 minutes, it'll just cook on, and it'll be perfect. Right, come on guys, follow me, food's up.
All that remains to be done now is to plate them up. Remember, take your time and make it look nice, even when you're making a meal for 14.
Excuse me, Lord Buller.
And there you have it, loin of rum venison in a rich red wine sauce with stove potatoes and roasted vegetables.
How going, guys? You hungry? What do you reckon?
Beautiful.
Nice, nice.
Really brilliant. No Bristol here.
No. Can I just propose a wee toast? Rum venison.
Rum venison.
Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you.
If you want to know more about any of the things we did or the places we visited on Rum and Muck, then call 0800 077 077. Calls are free and the lines are open 24 hours a day.